And so today we are looking at that one word, almighty, that God is omnipotent. He is almighty. Our passage that I chose is Job chapter, well, there's a lot of passages that I could have chosen, but I kept coming back to this one as I was thinking about it. It's, of course, at the very end of the book, near the end of the book of Job, the last chapter. And I just want to remind you about the book of Job so that we see this in some context. The book of Job begins, you know, that Job is a righteous man. He's a follower of Yahweh, and he has means. He is a wealthy man, and there's this scene in heaven where Satan comes before the throne of God, and God says, you know, have you considered my servant Job? And Satan's answer is, well, yes, of course he follows you. You've blessed him so abundantly. You know, you've given him every good thing. You put a hedge about him. Nothing wrong happens to the guy. Of course he's a follower of yours. And then God there allows Satan to test Job, to test Job's faith. And upon doing that, in a very short time, Job gets a report that enemies have come and they've slaughtered a bunch of his servants and livestock. And then that fire has come and consumed a bunch of other servants and his sheep. And then his all of his children were gathered together in the eldest home. And a great windstorm came and the house collapsed and all the children died. I mean, it had happened boom, boom, boom. He got all this word that he's lost all of his wealth and he's lost his children. And there's nothing. And then, nonetheless, Job was faithful and did not curse God, and then God allowed Satan to batter his body, but not to kill him. And so we read that then Satan struck Job with loathsome sores from the soles of his feet to the crown of his head. I mean, oh, just miserable. So, you know, Job went from the heights of family life and had material wealth and health, and all of that was removed. And then three friends come and visit Job in order to comfort him, but they comfort him with bad theology. And in that bad theology, they were implying that Job really must have done something very bad. Nothing comes from nothing. Nothing ever could, or nothing ever will. In my youth and childhood, I must have done something good. Some bore theology in that song. But that's kind of what the three friends were promoting. Job doesn't agree with them. He doesn't fully follow what they're saying, and he doesn't agree with what they're saying, but he does come to the conclusion that God has somehow become his enemy. And so he says, if only I could plead my case in the courtroom of heaven, in God's courtroom, if I could come before him and bring my defense, because somehow something's gone wrong. And that's kind of just where he's at, and he needs to plead his case. And so in chapter 38, so all of that happens now in the first 37 chapters. In chapter 38, God comes and speaks to Job. And there it begins this way. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Dress for action like a man, and I will question you, and you make it known to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. And then if you know the book of Job, you know that God just is relentless in coming with question after question. Where were you when, you know, I spread the expanses of the heavens? And where were you when I created the stars and put them in their place? And I mean, you know, all of that was God just leaves Job speechless. And then Job 40, verse 2, shall a fault finder contend with the Almighty? Job actually says that. With the Almighty. The Almighty. God is omnipotent. That's what we're looking at today, the omnipotence of God, that God is almighty. He is, that means he is all-powerful. And God Almighty is, in the Hebrew, El Shaddai. El Shaddai. All-powerful. Almighty. I know you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted, Job says. What this is saying is God possesses all power. Every power that we see in creation is a delegated power. It's like on loan. But God is the powerful one. Even our power of life, of living. Steve Lawson says this, and I appreciated this. I thought that was very insightful. He says, there's a sense in which God doesn't even have to take our life. He just stops giving it. Isn't that interesting? It isn't that he takes our life. He just stops giving it. He just withholds, you know, because he's the all-powerful one. He's the one who energizes us. He's the one who gives us any energy whatsoever. Lord's Day 9, question 28 of the Heidelberg Catechism, the answer says, in part says, all creatures are so completely in his hand that without his will they can neither move nor be moved. It's kind of the same idea. If God just removes his power from us, we're done. We're done. And that's true of all creation. And the story of Job teaches us that even the devil, who has very little power in comparison to God, is under God's power. So what we want to say, what I want to say first of all is that when we talk, and again, we've done this before, we've noticed this already, when you talk about one of the attributes of God, it is always in connection with the other attributes of God. And so that God is all-powerful, that is infinite omnipotence. It is infinite. That means it's unlimited. It's boundless. Or maybe to say that a little bit better, we might say it's limited, but it's limited to the nature of who God is. In other words, God is... God doesn't have the power to lie. Okay, that God cannot do that because that is not in God is truth, and that is not in his nature. Understanding that you know, we want to say God is able to do whatever he pleases. This is in keeping with what Job says. Isn't it? I know you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Whatever God purposes, whatever God wills, God is able to accomplish and do. He is infinite, unlimited, boundless in his power. As I was preparing for this, I think in every one of them, every one of the commentaries and those that I read, that talk about God's power always goes to creation, but I think that's rightly done because the Bible often does that. He who created the heavens and the earth, you know, he is your stay, and he is your shield. So you know, creation. I mean, who of us hasn't at some point been in awe as we've looked at creation? It may be, you know, you're in the Rocky Mountains and you're just looking around and saying, wow, You just, you know, because it is this amazing. Or a little over a year ago, you know, Debbie and I were at the Grand Canyon, and you stand there on the edge, and it's just like, wow. You know, you can't help it, right? You just can't help it. Or you're, you know, on a clear night, and you're out camping, and there's, you know, you see the stars, and it's like, oh, wow. That's just, you know, who of us haven't done that? Or been at the beach and looking over the ocean and just looking at the expanse of that and just like, wow, God, it's just, he is great. How great is a God to create such a place? And I think that's good. It's good that we have those moments of like, oh, it's just, it's amazing. And God created all that we see, all that is, ex nihilo, from nothing. I mean, so I'm bringing out the power of God, okay? Just so that we, because I know we've talked about ex nihilo, that God created ex nihilo, and that's, we profess that, and that is true. But just think about the power to just speak, and something comes into existence. It's an amazing, incomprehensible power for us. We cannot comprehend it, but it's an amazing thing. God did not use any pre-existing material, and nor did God place creation into a pre-existing place. So I mean, once you start to try to wrap your mind around it, it's just, you know, we can't actually. We can't wrap our mind about it. God created space and time and material, and it's really beyond our ability to even comprehend it. But then, and to think about it, that he did it so with his voice. You know, we don't actually create things as humans. We reorganize and reshape things that already exist. And then, you know, that's what we do. But God created out of what did not, created from what did not previously exist. And it's just incomprehensible to us. And he did so with ease. It wasn't like God had to expend all kinds of effort in order to make it happen. He does all of this with ease. All the power that was required to do all that he wills lies within him in undiminished fullness. Just, you know, it's not like he's tapping in and it's starting to, you know, his energy is starting to go less. God doesn't use tools. He doesn't use instruments. He has no helpers. In Isaiah 44, verse 24, it says, I am the Lord who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by myself. You know, it's just amazing. And, yeah, and it's actually staggering. Again, you know, I'm sitting at my desk and working on this sermon, and it's just like I'm shaking my head thinking about it. You know, you think about a light year, right? Think about a light year. If you don't know what that is, that's the distance that light, traveling at 186,000 miles per second, can travel in a year. That's a light year. 186,000 miles a second. Now start to, you just think about that number and what a year, that year is. It's 186,000 times 60. It'll get you to a minute. Times 60, that'll get you to an hour. Times 24, that'll get you to a day. Times 365. And you started out with 186,000. You start doing that, and it's mind-blowing. That big, that incredible. That's one light year. It's a staggering distance. And the scientists are telling us that the diameter of the known universe is 93 billion light years. Just let that start sinking in. That's just, it's, we can't comprehend it. It's amazing. Our galaxy, the Milky Way, has billions of stars. And it's only one of countless galaxies. And our, you know, the Webb telescope, and these are starting to show these things. It's like, wow, amazing. You know, when the disciples, think about this, when the disciples, it says, when they were on in the boat with Jesus, and Jesus was sleeping, and there was a storm going on, and they were getting concerned about their very life, and finally Jesus wakes up, and he says to the wind and the storm, be still. And everything calmed down. And then we're told, and the disciples were even more afraid. Who is this that the wind and the seas obey him? And they were just astonished that Jesus, with a word, could calm the seas. But here's the thing. Jesus, with a word, made the seas and made the wind. He is almighty. And all of this is testimony to the staggering power of God. And the Bible regularly refers to this almighty power as the source of comfort for us. And that's good. I want to make sure that we recognize this. Like in Colossians 1, for instance, for by him all things were created in heaven and on earth. It's talking about Jesus, by him, Jesus. All things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him. And then that passage goes on to say that this Christ, through whom everything was created, is head of the church. And that in him, we who were alienated have now been reconciled. And so what it's doing is it's just making this point. Paul is, you know, Paul gets it. He's making the point. This is this almighty God who created everything, which is unfathomable to us, but is amazing. We know that such power is beyond our comprehension, but this is the one who's head of the church. And he's the one who has reconciled us to the Father. That's the one with whom we have to do. What a great comfort that is to us. I mean, if God can create all things, think about it. If God can create all things, there's nothing too difficult for him. And so we can come to him with our prayers and our petitions with boldness and confidence. God can do it. You know, Romans chapter 1 points out that this power of God, his creative power, is what leaves people without excuse. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So all we need to do is look at creation, look at the world, and it testifies to God's omnipotence, his almighty power. And that power is unending. It's inexhaustible power. You know, God isn't growing tired in upholding. He's upholding the earth. It doesn't stop. He's continuing to uphold the earth and all things. God isn't perspiring. He isn't growing old and weary. He's not breaking down. You know, there's none of that. There's no diminishing. He loses none of his omnipotence. In Isaiah 40, it says, verse 28, have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. He does not faint or grow weary. Again, he's the creator. He's the maker. So the Bible continually does that. It brings it back to You want to know how almighty God is? Look at creation. The creator of heaven and earth neither faints nor grows weary. God doesn't get tired. And in fact, God, he energizes us. We're the weak ones. We're the ones who grow tired. He gives power to the weak. And to those who have no strength, he increases strength. That's what that passage goes on to say. But again, there's no prayer request is beyond God's ability to answer. And so we should come boldly then to the throne of God. And our prayer isn't, if you're able. We know he's able. Is it your will? Right? That's our prayer. Oh, Lord, if it's your will, would you do this? Because we know you're able. But is it your will? Well, another thing we want to say is, I've been bringing out already, that his omnipotence is incomprehensible. In other words, we can talk about it all that we want. We cannot wrap our minds around it. Ephesians 3:20, I love this passage. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think or imagine. All that can enter our mind. God can do far more than what can even enter into our minds. According to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God's power is it's infinite and it's unending. It is incomprehensible to us. But another very important point I want to make about it is that it is irresistible. It's irresistible. And this is where I think believers can find great comfort. God is undefeated. He's undefeated. He's undefeated. No one can resist God. He is the triumphant one. He is invincible. He is undefeated. No purpose of yours can be thwarted, Job says. In Isaiah 14:27, it says, "For the Lord of hosts has purposed, and who will annul it? His hand is stretched out, and who will turn it back?" Of course, these are rhetorical questions, but they're with an understanding that the answer is, well, no one, you know? The Lord of hosts has purposed. Who's going to annul it? And his hand is stretched out. Who's going to turn it back? There's no one capable of doing that. God's omnipotence is irresistible. And one of the things we want to say about the power of God is that he is powerful to save. In other words, we can be amazed at the power that God can create ex nihilo, out of nothing, all the creation that we see. But he is also able to bring that which is spiritually dead and has the power to bring it to life. He is powerful to save. Zephaniah 3:17 says this, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save." Or some says he is mighty to save. I love that, mighty to save. He's a mighty one who will save. "He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing." He is mighty to save. It's like in Ezekiel 37 where the Spirit of God brings Ezekiel to this valley of dry bones. And God asks him, "Son of man, can these bones live?" You know, the picture is, of course, a bunch of, like it's an old field of battle, and it's these dead soldiers have been lying there on the ground and they've decomposed, and there's just a bunch of bones lying on the ground. Son of man, can these bones live? Ezekiel was wise at that point, says, "Oh Lord, you know." He wasn't about to push his own answer there. You know, Lord. And, of course, God tells him to prophesy. Prophesy to these bones and they will live. And it goes on. These bones are the children of Israel that God gives life to. He is powerful to save. He is mighty to save. And Jesus says to us, reminding us of this, John 6:37, all that the Father gives me will come to me. We hold to that, don't we, with irresistible grace. All that the Father gives to me will come to me. And then later he says in John 10, I give them eternal life, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. And I and the Father are one. Do you see, this is where there's such great comfort in knowing the omnipotence of God. If he has purpose that you be redeemed, that you're saved, there's nobody that can thwart that. Nobody's powerful enough to snatch you out of his hand. He's got you. And that's forever. That's forever. So we do not lose heart. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. You think about that. That's by the power of God, we are being renewed day by day. But then you go on and think about, yeah, and so our bodies in this life are wasting away. They most certainly are. To where we die before Christ returns. We're going to be laid into a grave. And these bodies will decompose and all of that. And yet, God is powerful. And though our bodies are laid in the grave, we will be raised with that same power that raised Jesus from the dead. With the same power that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Lazarus come forth. You know, I heard a great, this is a side thing, it's not in my notes. It's free. I heard it this week. If Jesus didn't say Lazarus, all the dead would have raised. Isn't that interesting? Come forth. That was a word of power. That was an almighty word of power and life that if he didn't focus on Lazarus, all the dead would be raised at that point. So I just thought that was an interesting point, but that's the power of God. So even though our flesh is wasting away, our outer self is wasting away, and our inner self is being renewed day by day, praise the Lord for that. But praise the Lord that he's going to, with his almighty power, raise up our dead bodies. These mortal bodies will be immortal. And we will live with him for all eternity. So the omnipotence of God is just a great, wonderful comfort for the people of God. And what a joy and privilege it is that God has revealed that to us and keeps telling us, I'm the creator. You can count on me. You can count on me. There's nothing that can stop my hand. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that you are almighty. You are the almighty God. And the El Shaddai, we thank you that you've revealed this to us and that, Lord, we can be comforted and assured. What a great, wonderful truth this is for our comfort. And so, Lord, we praise you and we give glory to your name, for you, Lord, are worthy. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.